Better say, you better fasten your seat belts, because we're going to take a journey. I don't know how many times that I have fussed over Isaiah chapter 40. But in the process of it, one time when I was in Mongolia, I visited with my driver interpreter, to visit a lot of the yurts that were in the area of the city. And we came to this one particular yurt, and these yurts are the round tent-like things that they have. And the elderly guy in there was quite sick. And when we got in there, my interpreter, the name was Sindin, and he told me that, or he asked me how old I was, and it turned out that the man that was sick was the same age that I was. Matter of fact, same month of birth, which was kind of startling. But the point is that Cindy wanted me to give him something from the scriptures that would help him in his distress. And for some reason or other, I went to Isaiah chapter 40. And the idea of the situation that when we are faithful to God, God gives us strength that we don't know that we have. And that particularly in the elder years of our lives, as we strive to walk in the Lord conscientiously, obediently, then as you know, with regard to the habits of the eagles, when their chicks are ready to be knocked out of the nest to fly, one of the things that the eagle does is to carry that chick until it does start flying. Now, another thing about the eagle is that when it molts, it loses its feathers, a lot of the feathers, and these feathers are replaced by the renewing growth that God has given them, so that they can continue to lift up these chicks, that their whole existence exists in such a thing. It's marvelous from that standpoint that Isaiah would take such an example of nature and give us a distinct lesson that would tell us that there is something for us to do because there is something that God has already done. So, inquiring minds, and that's what I would like for you to look into yourself for, inquiring minds that seek to know. Now, the question might be to seek to know what? And that depends on your background, I guess, or your attitude, or what you have experienced through your lives. The point here is that with regard to this particular scripture, you have that Jacob and Isaac, not Jacob, but Isaac, but Judah and Israel, that are mentioned first. So what we have here is an example of how God dealt with the Israelite nations. And in so doing, they're seeking and they're probing and they're looking for the things of God were something they were very busy at. And sometimes when they ceased to do that, they found themselves in trouble. Here are some things that I would like for you to consider. For your own spiritual welfare and security in the everlasting life which God has prepared for us all, seek to know. And that is to seek to know the heart of your Creator. Number one, the very first commandment is to have no other gods before us, but the one living God, that is, through Jehovah himself. Now, in such a way, we have a focus here. You might say you've driven the nail into the wall and now everything's going to start hanging on it, from the standpoint that since he is this one God, he is the creator of all that exists, that from that standpoint, we need to seek him. Now, seeking is to reach out to put some effort into knowledge and understanding that knowledge, and from the standpoint of understanding that knowledge, to apply it to one's life. Now, that's true of this world as well as it is in the spiritual aspect of it. Those that commit themselves to do a certain form of lifestyle, or from that standpoint to have the ability to live in this world and be productive in this world to the point of being real rich. I guess that's what they really look for. To seek to know the heart of your Creator is the number one point here. The second point is that all that He has written in His book, that's the groundwork for which we begin to know God. And if we are not imbibing ourselves in the reading of the Scriptures, we can never know God, even from the standpoint of preachers. Matter of fact, sometimes preachers become a stumbling block rather than an educator. What we want to know is, and what we should know, is what God has written, and in the process of that writing, to consume it as though it were the bread of life. Now that ought to say something to you right there, because in John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Then we find later in John where Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Now, what does that tell you? Well, it tells me, anyways, that the substance of real life is in Christ Jesus. It is spiritual, and that we must consume Him. And He says Himself in the Gospel of John, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink His blood, you have no life in you. I hate blood. I don't like to drink blood. Never had, never will. Even though I like meat. But when I buy meat, I want no blood in it whatsoever. But that is this world. What I want is the purity of the substance of my Savior Jesus Christ. And in the process of learning that, I have to seek for it. Which implies that if I'm developing a faith of any kind, I've got to work at it. The idea that religious people have saying all you need is faith only have a great stumbling block that is going to knock them down every time. Because it comes down to this: God has gone as far as He has gone for the salvation of our souls by sacrificing His own Son that we might have eternal life. And if we can't appreciate that, and by appreciating it, stand on the principles which God has taught us, then we might be just as Jesus would say to others, why is it you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? That's not honest, it's deceptive, and you're cheating yourself. We want to seek to know, and we want to seek to know from the source that gives the real information. And that's not drama. That's not reading textbooks of different kinds of nature, but the inspired Word of God itself. Now understand that Jesus is the Word. He is the communicating aspect of God's relationship to mankind. In the lesson that we had this morning with regard to Daniel, you'll note that how that God Himself didn't actually come down and bring them out of this burning... What was that they were in? Huh? Oh, you're listening. Good. But there was someone there, wasn't there? And there was a third person, and in the fourth person, and they were brought out unscarred. Got a little off the key there. But the point here is that from this standpoint, the Scripture tells us that our faith is based upon the foundation of the prophets and the apostles. That means that God has put into these men the true revelation and revealing, if you will, of God's desire and what He demands with regard to our relationship with Him. If He is holy and we want to be with Him, we have no other option but to be holy ourselves. And the only way that we can be holy ourselves is to feed upon the Lamb of God. And if we're not feeding upon the Lamb of God, we need to start examining what it is we're seeking for. And if we have to change course, then we need to get to the helm and start turning that wheel. And get that rudder in the right path that we can sail our bark to that eternal shore that God has set before us. And that is ours, really. But remember this also, that as Jesus was carrying His cross, He had already been beaten up, bled, and sent on His way, and He couldn't carry the cross all the way. Now you say, well, now He's Christ, He's got a lot of power. Yes, that's true. But remember that He was a human being in this respect. That means mortal as you and I are, as far as life in this world. Now the thing is, He was innocent of this all, but in coming to the cross, as He fell, the soldiers that were there accompanying Him saw that He couldn't possibly carry it all the way in the condition that He was in. So He went over and asked this young man, you know, a nice strong young man, if he wouldn't please volunteer to carry it for Him. Isn't that right? No, that's not right. What is right is that in carrying that cross, they went over to this guy and they said, look, you're going to carry it for Him whether you like it or not. I don't remember the guy's name. I don't even remember Tommy's name. But the point is that in this respect, He carried the cross behind Christ. Now, when Christ Himself brings this out in another way, He says, except you take up your cross and follow after Me, you have no life in you. Well, what does that mean? We have the troubles and trials of this world. We have the inconsistency of our own mind and our heart, our dreams that sometimes come in conflict with what we are to be dreaming about with regard to faith, hope, and the charity that God has given us, the greatest of these being that charity, as Paul brings out in 1 Corinthians 13:13. What we see here, there is a form that needs to be studied and understood. In this situation, we see, again, we seek to know. We seek to know the power He gives over the weaknesses that we have, our weaknesses. And believe me, that this is something that you may not like, because there is this one thing that stands in the way: your responsibility to yourself. If you say, oh, I love Jesus, and you sing the song, oh, how I love Jesus, but you're not doing the things that Jesus has taught you, then you don't love Jesus. So you need to make some changes in your life. And in the process of making those changes in your life, then you're going to start saying to yourself, I need to know the power that is given. The power that He has given over my weaknesses, over your weaknesses. Now, this world is mortal, as you and I individually are mortals. And it's coming to an end. As a matter of fact, you can see visually some of the changes that are taking in the world, not just in the humanity that is on the world, but the world itself in its tossing to and fro. The continental drift, for example, obviously is still in motion. The world is changing. It is mortal. And as everything else that belongs to mankind and in the environment of mankind, it will come to an end. It will be rolled up like a scroll. And there is not going to be anything that survives except those who diligently, earnestly, and sincerely seek the counsel and the guidance of God. of the living God. We want to seek to know. We want to seek the Creator. We want to seek to know. And if we get that from the standpoint of the book that God has given us, we want to seek to know that the power that He has over our weaknesses is something that we can utilize in our life for a better life and a service to the living God. We want to seek to wait on the Lord and renew our strength, to seek to mount up with eagle wings, as we see in Isaiah chapter 40. Now, this is not being braggadocious in this respect. It's not from that standpoint of, you know, touting something that I have special that you don't have, but from the standpoint of this desiring to know faith, you got to understand that faith originates from the consuming of the Word. Faith comes by the hearing of the Word. And if you're not receiving that Word, and you're not feeding upon that Word, then there is no way that you're going to grow in strength of faith and understanding. Brother Michael has, since he's been here, has had on the board out there, reading through your Bible in a year's time. And in the process of doing that, how many have actually done that, by the way? I see a couple of fingers going up. Need to raise your whole hand. Fingers are hard to see, you know. Yeah. When I first started reading the Bible, I didn't know where to start. So like any other book that I've ever written, I started at the beginning. And I found Genesis being very revealing for me. It gave me some comfort and some answers that I needed with regard to what is all this about, you know. Then I got into Exodus, and from that standpoint, I discovered that there are some other problems here with regard to the Israelites, and that they had been taken down to Egypt, and they had become slaves, and now they're going to go back to the Promised Land, or what became the Promised Land. And in that respect, I got to Deuteronomy, and I thought, Deuteronomy, man, what is this all about? The activities of the priests, the appointments of the priests, the laws that were there, which guided them, that they had the holy place and the most holy place, and woe unto you if you get in the wrong place at the wrong time. Or even if you get in the wrong place at the right time, there's problems there. And then, of course, Leviticus and Numbers that come after that. I laid my Bible aside because I didn't have any interest in that. So I started with the New Testament and began to read through the New Testament. And that went quite smoothly. But what I would do, and I made myself this promise, I would read the one book in the New Testament, and then I'd go back to the Old Testament and read one book there. And then I'd go read one from the New Testament, and through that, I hop, skipped, and jumped through the New Testament three times before I could even get started with the Old Testament. But eventually, I got through it, and I've been reading the Old Testament ever since. Now, I was seeking to know. I was in a situation that's all I had to do was to seek and know. From that standpoint, though, again, I want to use this word, not to be braggadocious in any way, but from the standpoint of growing in faith, and it's your responsibility to grow in faith. God has given you everything that you need in order to grow and survive in this world, and to grow strong. To start out with the sincere milk of the Word, and once you have matured enough to put away the sincere milk of the Word, you can get into the meat of the Word. And in the process of eating in the meat of the Word, you grow stronger. Now, as you grow in age, you find out that there is other things that come in. We're mortal. And in the process of that mortality, we lose a lot of the strength that we have. From that standpoint, also, we see that we find ourselves in trouble with a lot of things of our life because of the weakness of age. But in the spirit, age means nothing. In the spirit is the strength of life. And through that, you grow in the spirit. The shell that you live in is going to be cast aside, and when that resurrection comes of all the righteous, then you will be given a new garment to wear. And in the process of that new garment to wear, this will be what you have in your eternal life. We have some examples here, and I'm just going to deal with one with regard to asking and receiving. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 8 and 9, I'm just going to refer to it. I'm assuming that you've read some of the Bible somewhere. And I'll put it out this way. Ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it be open unto you. And as long as you seek, you will find it. And as long as you knock, it will be open to you. And so forth. The point is here that we're asking God to do a lot of things for us. Okay? Well, that doesn't compute, really. It's not the idea of God doing things for us, but from the standpoint that if we seek diligently and we press forward in that seeking, we will gain the advantage. The same thing is true with regard to everything else that comes as a part of our spiritual well-being and the aspect of that well-being to the glory of God. One of the things that I admire about this particular congregation, and that is that the good works that we're striving to do, limited as we are with those that are able to help and the money that is involved with regard to reaching out into the community to invite them in to share the wonder and the glory of the living God in the spirit and truth which God has given it and demands of it, then what we have here is our duty to God and to serve God. As Jesus points out in another place, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Now, isn't that something to work for? Isn't that something to take pride in? No, you don't need to take pride for it. Because every servant does what is expected of him. Every servant is obedient to his master. And we are, in one way or another, servants of God. In that sense, when we go down into the watery grave of baptism with our Christ and our Savior, and we say to the world and we say to the community that I believe, I do more than believe that in Christ Jesus, I'm striving to obey him, and in the process of that obedience, I am willing to put to death all my sins and to put it aside so that, and Paul brings this out in his letters, that we if we are buried with him in baptism, then we can rise to walk in newness of life. We put the old man of sin to death. Now, in my work with inmates and even ex-offenders, one of the things that I've run across, and I've kind of given it a label of my from myself, and I call it a baptism that is stillborn. He's going through the act. The individual's going through the act. But there's no life after that. I don't know how many people that I have baptized in my career. I know that one year in the prison ministry, we had 80 baptisms in that year. Once in a while, I get a call from one of these individuals, and it's good to talk to them and to see how they're doing. On the other hand, most of them, and this is the way life is, I never hear from before. There is a serious problem here. Now, I do know that there are several people that are attending church here as members of the congregation that have not been baptized. I've talked to a couple of them, and I've offered to study with them, and they'll say they will, but we never have done it because they haven't come forward. they're deluding themselves, and they are abusing the opportunity that God has given them to be obedient to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now you notice that when Christ died on the cross, they took him down and they buried him in a grave. Why? Because he was carrying the sins of the world, your sins and mine. So what is the penalty of sin? Death, of course. But he was innocent. He took all our sins with him, so to speak. But in there, since he himself had no sin, was resurrected. Now that same example is given from the Gospel of John in particular. And that's in the third chapter of John. And in the process of that third chapter of John, what we are seeking for is the truth of God. And what we're going to find in that chapter is just part of the work of God and the understanding of God. When Nicodemus came to Jesus in that night, doesn't make any difference why he came at night. But he says, you know, to Jesus, we know that you are a man coming to God, because no man can do these things except God be with you. Now Jesus, anticipating, I suppose, his question, and he says, except a man be born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter or cannot see the kingdom of God. That's verse 3. And Nicodemus didn't understand that, as people today still don't understand it, though it's written clearly in the text. In verse 5, except a person be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. In verse 3, he says you can't even see the kingdom of God. In verse 5, he says you cannot enter it unless you are born of the water and the Spirit. Now, that's not talking about the water of the birth when you came out of your mother's womb. It's talking about the spiritual reality of implementing or even copying in a figurative way, a spiritual way, that Christ died for our sins. We're going to die to our sins, so we bury that sin in a watery grave, and we are lifted up, and as Paul brings out, to its newness of life, in newness of life. Now, isn't that what we want? Isn't that what we're here for? In Ecclesiastes, another episode that comes to my mind frequently, in the last chapter, chapter 12, in the last two verses, Solomon writes there, and what is the conclusion of the whole matter but to serve God and to keep his commandment? For this is the whole duty of man. Let's back up a little bit. The whole duty of man? What about my job? What about watching the Royals? What about, you know, taking a vacation? I mean, God can wait for me a little bit. I believe in him. I'm sincere. But there are things that I want to do. That doesn't count. That doesn't involve anything that's going to enhance your soul's salvation. No, what you need to do, and what we all need to do, and I'm not excluding myself in any way, that we are here to serve God and to keep his commandments. That is the whole duty of the human race. That's why God created the heavens and the earth. Now, there is a natural curiosity that we have just in the human sense. Our genealogy comes up from, you know, being down here with wooden tools and things of that nature, growing to the fact now that we don't even we have all this machinery that's doing things for us, and yet we still find ourselves unable to go to church regularly. Now, that's kind of selfish, particularly when God says your whole duty is to me. Not me, but God. I don't want you to be confused there. What I want you to be is to look into yourself as to what you're here for. Why are you here? Is it to join the Army whether it's the Salvation Army, the United States Army, and work for them the rest of your life? Or whether it is for joining the army of the Lord and to put on the helmet of salvation, the shield of faith, and the breastplate of righteousness. That's where we need to be. Now we pray for our soldiers and the danger that they get into, and that's right, and that's good. But there is something that is greater than that. That's our enlistment in the army of God. To wear that helmet of salvation and the breastplate of faith. In all of these things, we are doing the duty and honoring our God as we should. That's what our life is here for. And if you're not inclined to look to God for counsel and guidance and even strength, that when you fail in your strength from the standpoint of being weary and sick, that He will send that eagle that will swoop underneath you and lift you up. And that's what I saw in Mongolia with this sick Mongolian. He got excited. Though I was speaking English, it was translated into Mongol for him, but he knew what I was talking about. Now in Mongolia, they have a lot of eagles, I noticed. And as a matter of fact, I even got my picture holding one. But I found out later that he had risen from his sick bed and was doing just fine. Now, I'm not saying that's a miracle or anything, but what I'm saying is that his attitude changed. He was looking for healing, and in the process of looking for that healing, his mind was saying, hey, the Lord's going to lift me up. Now, this was a gentleman that was my age at that time, and he was striving to be a Christian. Now, I didn't stay in Mongolia long enough to follow through with that, and I assume, and hopefully, that he is still among the living. But in this, what we need is to continue in our own self, examining ourselves to where we are and why we are, and to know that there is a purpose that we have life that God has given us. It's not just an accident because your mother and father happened to come together. This was something that was planned from the very beginning. And in the process of that planning to fill the world with souls. But now we see that sin has entered in, and in the process of that sin entering in, all of us have found ourselves so guilty. And in the process of that guilt, it's a guilt without the help of God that we could never get away with. We could never avoid it, because it is the material of which we find ourselves bound in this physical world. Natural curiosity, I started to mention that before. If you notice your children, as they are born and they begin to understand, at least to comprehend some of the world around them in this limited way, you have to watch them, and you have to be careful with them because they're curious. They see something laying on the floor, the first thing they're going to do is see what it tastes like. Or if it's something that is hanging from some kind of lamp or something, they're going to see what it's for, does it move, or anything like this. They have a natural curiosity. And as they grow stronger from this infancy state to a crawling state and then to a walking state, then that curiosity grows consistently. Now, they need counsel. They need guidance from the standpoint of, seeking, understanding things that are going to benefit them. And the dangers also that come in not understanding what you're seeking for and find yourself choking on something you swallowed. Reminds me of my adopted son one time when he was just a little one. And evidently, he was with his mother at the time, and evidently he had been chewing on a ballpoint pen, and the head came off and he swallowed it. And when he did that, boy, he just really went berserk, I guess. He thought he was going to die, really. And she couldn't console him in any way until she called me on the telephone and wanted me to talk to him. And I told him that this was no real problem, that in due time it would pass through. And it did. And he checked it out. Now, that's the kind of seeking that we know. Sometimes it gets kind of nasty. But if we don't care about our lives, and one of the outside visions of knowing that you don't care really about your life is the kind of life that you strive to live. It's the kind of life that you put yourself in this world category. And in the process of this world category, you assume a certain position. It may not be the right position. It may be a very dangerous position. It may be a fruitless position. There's only one way to examine it. You got to seek to know. And in seeking to know means you've got to work at it. And if you're not working at it, then, you know, you're on your own. I know I've gone over time. So, and that's just the beginning. I'm going to look at it this way. When we concentrate on matters of our mind, in the minds, puzzling us, we soon learn that diligence and practice gives wisdom, courage, and resolution to our purpose in life, and a proper way to be productive and have results for our labors. And this includes us as a person, our families, our brethren, our neighbors, and everything that is around us. So in that, we need to exercise this diligence, we need to practice this diligence, and we need to mold it and seek it with some form of reality as to what we're striving for. And if we're not, then you can say, well, I was sincere, but it happened that way. Sincerity is one of the worst words that I know in the English language. Anything, regardless how bad it is, one can say, well, I was sincerely, you know, doing what I thought was right. Sincerely doesn't get it. There is a knowledge that is factual, and that knowledge that's factual is right here in your hands. Now, if you don't utilize that, if you live in a house that has no light, it has the electricity potential, but you never turned it on, then you're going to be in the dark. And the same thing is true with knowledge of God. If you're not pulling on those strings that bring out the Word of God, properly handled, then you're going to be in the dark. So the thing is to get in the light and to practice those things of the light, that not only in this world, but in the one to come, you have that sanctitude, and you have that confidence, and you have that faith, which you have received through the written word, and your salvation for eternal life. One of the things I like to do with the inmates, and sometimes some of them have life sentences, and I ask them, what would you rather do if you had a choice? To spend your life in prison for what you've done, or to spend your life in hell for what you've done? Doesn't balance out, does it? And the fact that it doesn't balance out shows that there's something there that's wrong. But if I had to be in prison, and I was in prison, and if I just give in to it, then I'd probably still be in prison, because I wasn't a very nice boy. But the point is that when God lifts you up on eagle's wings, things happen. And I'll close with this little note. When I came out of the prison, Cindy and I were remarried. And almost immediately, we ended up with two foster girls. And with that, we had some adjustments to make. But one day I got a telephone call from the state of Illinois, and the lady said, "I'm looking for William Crossman." I said, "You found her." She said, "You're supposed to be in Illinois." And I said, "Why?" She said, "Because when you came out of the federal prison, the state of Illinois had a hold on you for some stuff that you did in Illinois." And I thought, wow, not only was I out of prison, I was going back, you know. Well, we talked a little bit, and bless her heart, and this is one of those, things that God does for us, I guess. When she saw the situation that I was in, because we'd have to give up the foster children and things like that, and I even told her that I was already going back into prison, you know, teaching the gospel, she took my case to the Board of Paroles in Illinois and got me a discharge. They dropped all the charges. Now, if that's not the providence of God, I've never had one. But that's God lifting us up on eagle's wings. And it's your opportunity this morning, if you have not obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, or if you have obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, but you have let down your guard for the world instead of serving God, today is a good day to correct that, to seek that which is of God and eternal, rather than seeking those things which are here in this world and mortal. Think about that as we stand to sing at this point this song of invitation. Because it is an invitation. Even Jesus makes that invitation when he says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find grace to your souls." Let's stand and sing that song.